Hello everybody, Andy Greenacre here, visual artist based here in sunny Suffolk. You meet me back in my creative corner of my studio. And today we're going to be learning about some more elements in art, and today we're looking at shape. We've already looked at colour, form, texture and value, but today we're going to look at how shape is used by artists and creatives in their work, and hopefully we're going to understand it a little bit better so we can use it in our own creations, or if we're looking at something that an artist has made, we can start to understand why they've made the choices that they've made. So, shape today, and hopefully by the end of this you'll have experimented with some of the tasks that we're doing, you'll have had a lot of fun, and as I said, you'll have understood what shape is and how creatives use it to add effect and detail and different emotions to their work. Okay, so what is shape? Shape is simply a line, an outline of something that creates an area within an image. It's a contour. And if you imagine a line being joined back up to itself, that creates an enclosed space, and we call that a shape. It's a 2D thing as well. But we're going to start by looking at different types of shapes, because it's important to understand that artists use these to create a mood or a feeling, or try and add an element to their photograph or their painting or their sculpture or their architecture to make you feel a certain way. So is it a natural form that makes you feel comfortable and in touch with nature, or is it a geometric shape that may be slightly more solid and stable, or maybe it's something that is very sharp and pointed? So we're going to look at the different types of shape that are used by artists and creatives, and then we're going to have a go at drawing some ourselves. So to start with, I thought we'd look at shapes that I think are quite similar in their construction, but are very different in how we describe them. And we're going to start with a shuttlecock from badminton and a leaf from a tomato plant. Now, they're both very elaborate shapes. We would describe them as elaborate, detailed shapes. And we're looking at them in one direction, so 2D, a silhouette of these. I could draw around them if I wanted to, and actually that would show the detail very clearly. Now, the shuttlecock has straight lines, it has perfect circles, it has little squares where the lines intersect, it's got a triangular shape as well. All those words that I'm using are geometric, mathematical shapes, and that's how we develop our understanding and terminology of a geometric shape. Now, we may say this is just as detailed, this leaf. It has lots of lines on it, it's got some curves, it's got intersections and crossing over of those lines, but it's very much more loose and natural, free-flowing forms. This curve will not be the same as this curve. These lines will never be the same. It's like a fingerprint. And we call this a natural shape. So we've got natural organic shapes, and we've got geometric mathematical shapes. So let's have a look at another couple while we're here. So we've got a mathematical device for measuring angles, which is circular. You might have seen those as a half moon before, another shape we'd talk about. We've got a pebble, which actually is a brick that's been in the sea, battered about, it's all smooth. But both of these objects, or these shapes, if we were to draw around them, have curves. But this one is a geometric shape because it's exactly perfectly circular. And it has actually lines on it as well, and another circle inside, and little tiny straight lines all the way around, denoting all the different degrees and angles. And this one has exactly the same level of detail. It has curves, has little tiny specks on it, lots of detail. But this is a natural form and a natural shape. So we've got, again, a geometric mathematical shape, a natural organic shape. So both similar in the fact that they're detailed shapes, but a very different terminology and also a different categorisation. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to split this piece of paper into two. I'm going to have geometric and I'm going to have natural shapes. And I'm going to draw as many as I can that I can find around my house and my studio. I'm going to do that for you, and then I want you to try and have a go yourself as well. We'll be right back. Okay, so I've finished my page of different shapes. It's quite a fun one to do because you can start to make them up, you can find objects to draw. I've just come up with them mainly from imagination. So they're geometric and natural shapes. Now the geometric shapes should technically be drawn with a ruler and also perhaps drawing around something that's circular or using a compass. But I've just drawn them to denote what they are. But if you wanted to spend more time doing that, then you could. The natural shapes are just free-flowing. And remember what we said, it's a line joining up with its tail to create an area that is enclosed. So I've done that with even with the hand. I've actually closed off the hand underneath it. So there's a hand, a splodge, a leaf, or it could be a feather. There's a snail, there's a stone, a splodge, a footprint, an apple, something that looks like a holly kind of shape. There's what looks like some sort of worm or snake and some wave formation. They're all natural shapes. We go over to geometric shapes. These have a much more mathematical approach to them. So we've got things like a square, a triangle, a circle, a rectangle. We've got a star, another type of star, a cross. There's another kind of star. There's some sort of longer, more elongated triangle and rectangle there and there. There's also something that looks a little bit like a bike wheel with the spokes on it. So these are all geometric shapes, and you can hopefully see there's a massive difference between the two styles, and creatives use this to their advantage. So an architect might use triangles because it's stable and it gives a sense of stability when you're in a building, and that's why they use triangles a lot. They're also mathematically very strong shapes. But an artist may also equally choose to use the shape of waves to create that kind of emotional movement that you might want to see in a painting. So these are the shapes that artists, creatives, designers use, and we're going to go on to explore them further in the next part of this session. So we've looked at 2D geometric and natural shapes. And what's a really useful tool is to use those shapes to build up when you're drawing. So if you're drawing something natural form like a hand, you can actually build it up with geometric shapes like squares and circles and rectangles. And those building blocks will help you make the structure, and then you can start to work on top of it to make it look like a natural form. So using the two together can be really useful. And that's what I'm going to do for you now and try and talk you through that as well. So when you look at your hand, you can actually see a large block of your hand. And I'm going to draw that to start with. And for me, it's a very obvious sort of diamond shape, really. And it sits there quite nicely on the page. It's a nice diamond. I'm going to add another diamond, another shape on the back of it. And that's starting to look, for me, a bit like my hand and my wrist as well. So then what I can start to do is add in other shapes. So I'm going to add a triangle in here. And we've got the part of the hand coming out here that your thumb is attached to. And then from that, I can start to add other shapes. So I'm going to start to add a rectangle on here. Slightly tapers, but it's a rectangle. Then what we're going to do is going to add another rectangle on here. And then I'm going to start to add some more rectangles on here, which actually gets slightly smaller as they go further away. So now I've got what I think starts to look a little bit like a hand. Now remember, when you're drawing things, sometimes you need to think about what isn't there as about as much as what is there. So sometimes the hand disappears, you don't see all of the fingers. And then on the end of it, I'm just going to draw a little circle. And if you want to, you can start to draw circles where the joints would be. And this can start to help you build up the kind of shapes that you think exist within a hand. So actually, to be honest, that's quite a lot easier than how I would normally draw a hand. And I actually struggle drawing hands. So I've got a rough shape using geometric shapes of squares, circles, triangles. And now what I'm going to do is try and draw over the top of this. I'm going to do that in pen. I'm going to show you how that can then become a really nice outline for a hand. Okay, so we've looked at shape, we've looked at geometric and natural forms, and we've had a go at using those to build up a drawing of a natural form of a hand, but using geometric shapes to build that up with squares and triangles and circles. So that worked quite well for me, and hopefully you've had some success too. But what I thought we'd try and do is try and create an artwork, like we do most weeks, to try and create a finished piece of work that brings all of the concepts together. And we're going to create something that's in the style of cubism. Don't worry if it isn't quite, but that's the starting point I'm going for, where there's lots of squares and circles and geometric shapes that I construct my image from. Now, subject, you can use whatever you want. I'm going to use a violin. The reason I'm doing this is because I actually created exactly the same kind of artwork when I was a teenager. I thought it'd be interesting to try and revisit that idea. Now, I haven't got the original artwork, but I'm going to have a go at making a cubist-styled artwork of my violin using some of the ideas of shape that we've learned about today. So have a go yourself if you want to. Pick something that you like that's in your house. It could be a plant, it could be something that's man-made, anything at all, and have a go, and I'm going to show you how I'm going to do that now as well. So to make my artwork, I'm going to use some pastels that are actually the pastels I used when I was a teenager that I found in an old box. I've just got a pencil. I'm going to use some geometric shapes, which happen to be mathematical equipment, ruler, things like that, which you don't tend to use in art, but I think for this I quite like to. So I'm going to try and make this artwork for you and see if you can have a go yourself. So I'm going to start making the shape of the violin. Let's start doing this with a geometric device that gives me some lovely curves. I don't want you to worry too much about it. Like with all these, it's really important that you enjoy the process as much as anything else. So if you don't like this thing that we're doing today, maybe don't do it and try something else. But don't worry, this is not a test. You don't have to do this. So the most important thing is that you enjoy what you're doing and get something from it. And that's the whole reason for why we do these things. As soon as the enjoyment comes out of something, I would say, take a breath, have a think about it, come back to it after having a nice cup of tea or a coffee and see how you feel about it then. Now notice I'm not being too particular about how I'm doing this, but I'm just going to add some of the detail in here as well. And actually, sometimes I'm going to do some kind of nice natural forms. And other times I'm going to do, so this is quite natural, these are the bits in the violin that make the sound. And I'm going to make the sound reverberate round. And I'm going to do that on this side as well. Notice I'm not worried about how they all sit together. Now, I'm going to actually start to go over these with some different shapes. I'm going to put a circle over the top of this. And also, over here somewhere, I'm going to add a square. Now I'm coming up with this as I go along. There's no sort of firm and fast way of doing this, but you can start to see different shapes and forms and bits and bobs appearing. So I'm actually going to put a triangle in here as well, because I quite like the idea of having a triangle cutting across everything. And there we go. So we've got some interesting things coming along. So I've got to draw in some more bits here. Now this is quite a nice organic shape as well. So I'm just going to draw that in. It's like a kidney, this one. I'm just starting to build up what I think it needs to look like. Now this, I'm going to have some playful elements here. So I'm going to start to bend these lines when they go through these shapes. So they're not actually quite as certain as they were. This one, again, I'm going to start to loosen up that line while it's in here and make it a lot more loose within that circle. So I'm giving myself these shapes to work within, which is quite a fun way of working. Now I've not done this for many years, so we'll just see how it turns out. And it doesn't matter if it doesn't turn out how you want, because this is just an experiment. I think probably somewhere in here I should have some sort of stave of music going across. And I feel from here it might be quite nice just to have running through this some lines like this. And I've got to remember how many lines there are on a music stave as well, which is quite a test. So let's have a look. I'm going to start adding some colour, I think, because I think it would be quite interesting to have a bit of colour in here that's different to the rest. So we've got these little pastels that I've got, which I quite like using them. They're really high in pigment. So I can start to add a bold triangle in here with that nice red infill. And what I might choose to do in that infill is use a little bit of a peach or a pink as well and start to bring that in. So you've got this really strong form appearing in that triangle, and it's got an element of this violin coming through it. Actually, it's quite a geometric abstract of what's going on. So yeah, you can start to play around with this as well. I think I'm going to do the same on this one as well, and actually have this as a green going up to the circle, and this is green as well. I think I've got a dark green in here as well. There we go. I'll start to build up this colour here. Start to smooth these out if you want to. That's entirely up to you if you want them to merge together, as I do, or you want them to be really crisp. Some people don't like using pastels because they can't get the right finish with them. I quite like the looseness that they force me to work with. I think it's quite interesting, even if you don't like something, to try it out and see how it affects the way you work as an artist. So I'm just going to put that in there, a little bit of that. I'm going to start to blend that out for this circle. There we go, becomes interesting shape as well. Now you can use all sorts of different materials. I'm trying to stick to basic materials because I quite like limiting my palette. So actually just using this is a really nice 8B pencil. Gives me that opportunity to get a lot of dark in here when I want to, but also you're not having to think about the cost. I mean, a set of these are not expensive, and a pencil and a piece of paper as well. That's all I've used for most of today. So
a tiny bit of black here. I'm just going to, I quite like that curve that's coming out of there. I'll add that curve in. There we go. And start to see
different shapes appearing within this piece of work. So I'm gonna add a bit of blue. Notice how I've got this line going across. So I think I'm going to start with that line actually, but I'm going to just see how I get on with this. So I'm going to carry on filming this from the top down and you can see it evolve. Have a go yourself and I'll show you the finished piece at the end. So let's have a little look at what we've learned today, and let's start by looking at the artwork that I've just made, which is a cubist-inspired drawing with pastels of my violin. And I did this as a teenager, as I said, and this is the final piece. So there's circles, squares, triangles, geometric shapes, and then the natural forms of a violin, which are inspired from nature, are used as well, plus lots of little squirrely bits, and there's also some of the notes have little tails on them, and the Fs of the violin that make the sound reverberate are on there as well. So there's a mixture of the two. Why don't you have a go at making one of these yourself and see how you get on? But what other things have we looked at today? Well, we started off by looking at geometric and natural shapes and trying to see if we could categorise them in two separate sort of sections. And that would help us when we're looking at art to see how creatives use shapes, both geometric, man-made, mathematical, and natural, organic shapes as well. We then went on to use this to create our very own drawing of a hand, which is a natural form, using geometric shapes, so a square, a circle, a rectangle, and then we drew on top of that to build up to this final artwork, so to speak, of a hand. So hopefully those have helped you, but what you can do is you can take this information, you can go away and look at other artists. There are lots out there that use shape, and nearly all artists use shape in different ways in their work. A great starting point would be someone like Mondrian, who uses large blocks of colour that are sort of surrounded with black bold lines, and they're very geometric. Also Paul Klee uses very geometric shapes. And earlier we looked at a shuttlecock, and that's no coincidence because a sculptor who uses very, very geometric shapes, is Klaus Oldenburg. And you can look at a large sculpture of a shuttlecock that he made. You can also look at people like Henry Moore, who uses natural forms in large bronze sculptures, and you can really see the natural forms coming through. And then you could go into more abstract areas like Judith Rothschild, who creates large paintings that are abstract, using different shapes in those works. So hopefully this has been really useful to you and you've learnt lots about shape. I'd love to see you here next time in my creative corner. My name's Andy. I'm an artist based here in Suffolk and I've really enjoyed you joining me. And next time we'll be looking at the next element of art, which hopefully will give you some inspiration to have a go, or at least understand art a little better when you're viewing it in the future. Thanks very much, guys. Bye.